I was asked to, I was sent the book by an entertainment lawyer who I know socially a little bit, and he said, would you please do me a favor, read this book, and then meet with my client, Molly Bloom, who I Googled her, read a few tabloid things about her, but I read the book. The book is a wild ride, but you're right. I went and I met with Molly, and that's when I was hooked, because what I discovered was two things. One, that the book was just the very tip of the iceberg. There was much more to this story, and it was a much bigger, deeper, more emotional story than just how she became the biggest game runner in the world. And the second thing, it was Molly herself, who was, that first meeting was just an hour long, and it would be followed by many hours of meetings after that. But she immediately struck me as brilliant, as strong as a tree. She's got a very sly sense of humor. It's very winning. And that she's built out of integrity. The more I heard of the real story, the more I knew that this is, I wanted to write this right now. This was a unique heroine found in an unlikely place. And this was a story about many things, including doing the right thing. And it appealed to my sense of romanticism and idealism.
Hello, everybody. Yes, in this film, we see Molly in many situations where she is following the rules that are laid out to her by men, her family, her industry, and the government. And I thought it was a really interesting character to play, but also to have someone like Aaron Sorkin, who's such a political filmmaker and does such incredible social commentary working on a film that deals with gender politics. I found it really fascinating to be a part of.
I think that I let it be about that. That's when I'm writing, I really try to stick to intention and obstacle as much as I can. There are going to be themes that are going to emerge, and when you do your second draft, you start to take away the things that aren't that, and leave that. But I think I knew that it was going to be about gender politics before I started writing it. Just talking to Molly, it was, one of the things we never really talked about was. It occurred to me, I don't know, in hour 73 or something of talking to Molly, that what if every woman in the course of her life meets five rotten guys, okay? Just in the course of a woman's lifetime meets five rotten guys. And what if a woman, a particular woman, what if those were the first five men she met? She met them all in a row, the first five men she met. It would kind of knock you a certain way. So I was thinking that while I was writing it, but I was certainly also thinking about what Jessica was talking about, which was that she had to navigate a world of very powerful men, men who, if they felt that Molly wasn't paying sufficient respect to their power, or Molly was paying more attention to someone else than she was paying to them, they had to finish her. They had to ruin her.
It's like a series of little plays. I mean, it's that kind of level of dialogue all the way through. No surprise, given it's written it. But but did you have much time to prepare for all of that, to get that kind of rhythm going?
Months.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. The short answer is no, we didn't have much time to prepare that. And it is very much the spine. I think Aaron has said that essentially the Charlie Jaffery character, which is in part, completely made up, is, of course, Aaron, to some degrees, point of view, at least, on some of the way that the whole case was handled, and also an entry point, perhaps, for the audience to be able to jump in and out without honestly breaking their minds with the logistics of a court battle like this. So it was a very clever device that Jessica and I got the privilege of playing, because it was like a play. Essentially, we had like 10 to 12 days to shoot all of those scenes, and you know, some of those scenes are sort of 10 pages long. And so Jessica was amazing, was already on set by the time I got there, but we just jumped in, we rehearsed a lot. We would essentially walk onto the set, show the crew, which was like, you know, a little bit of street theater every morning. And then we would go off and dissect this into the scene.
What it just means by the fictional element of Charlie is that there were two stories that I wanted to tell that were married to each other. One is the story that Molly tells in the book, which is the story of how she became the biggest game runner in the world. And then the other was the story that I was learning as I was talking to her. The idea that I went to this meeting without very high expectations because of the little that I had read from the tabloids, because of my own narrow mind of what I assumed after reading this book, that this was someone, that Molly was someone who was just gonna be cashing in on her decade-long brush with celebrity. And little by little, as we got more comfortable with each other, I discovered who she really was. I wanted to dramatize that as well. So, while Molly, of course, did have a criminal defense lawyer and someone she holds in very high regard, I never spoke to him or met him and didn't want to, because I needed that character for my own purposes. I wanted someone who was taking the journey with Molly, who was going from where Charlie goes of not having a lot of respect for her. Yeah. You don't need me, you need a publicist, that kind of thing, to the point where he's saying that you're my daughter's role model and I'm good with that.
Mm. Mm. Aaron introduced Molly and I at the Four Seasons in Los Angeles, which I thought was very fitting. And she was wonderful. I had she was a great resource for me in creating the character and talking to her about what she was feeling, what she thought about the players, even little things about clothing or how to present herself or what she would do during the games. And then also, in addition to that, I also wanted to talk to people who knew Molly. And so I met with some of the players who played in her game, and I went to a New York game and sat in, and it was very helpful.
I'd say, did you have any preconceptions about her before you met her in the way that Aaron did?
Yeah, I think I had the same preconceptions that Aaron had. You know, I Googled her, and then I noticed that I was starting to kind of have this judgment against her. You know, I was watching some interviews, and I saw some journalists not be so nice to her, and I was thinking, okay, I wonder, you know, what her goal is in all of this. And then I realized that the media was conditioning me to feel that way. You know, it's this, what we do is we, you know, have women, a woman is most valuable for her sexual attractiveness. And then the media tears her down afterwards. For me, it was very much a Kardashian story. I had the pictures of the Kardashians all over my trailer. In the sense, I was thinking of who are the most powerful women in our society, in this society we live in, and how did they get their power? And for me, it was the Kardashians.
You've seen who Time's Person of the Year is?
Me too. Yeah.
Sorry, ooh, to you.
Me too.
It's all the women who.
Oh yeah.
Didn't. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. It's good. Mm. Poor Donald Trump.
I was going to say I hadn't met her until the premiere, and then literally I realized at the premiere that she hadn't seen anything. So, you know, Jessica and I were sitting, you know, Jessica was sitting beside me, behind me on the same row, and I looked. I was like, she's not seen it. She was like, I know. I was like, oh no. What if she hates it? I mean, it was one of those moments, but she really loved it. She was very, very humbled by the whole process. You know, movie films, it's very romantic. It can be very, you know, flattering, but she was very humbled. I think because the film is a great film, and I think it depicts her in a way that perhaps she doesn't see herself, maybe.
She didn't see herself as a movie heroine, the way I did. She was surprised to be painted that way. Mm. Mm.
The decision, I mean, obviously, that around the memoir and things, a lot of discussion about who the people were around mm-hmm. the poker table. I mean, what was your attitude towards who you name and who you don't?
I didn't want to name anybody, and I did everything I could to... I knew there was going to be no avoiding, completely avoiding the who's this supposed to be and who's that supposed to be. But I was hoping to minimize the detective hunt because it's just not what the movie is about. As far as naming anybody, excuse me, that's not something I would want to do under any circumstances. I'm not up for gossip, but certainly in a movie where your heroine is heroic because she's unwilling to name people, the movie that she's in can't then go ahead and name people. It'd be crazy.
Great.
The movie, it turns out, is even more relevant than we expected it to be. I would happily trade the fortuitous timing of this for a world in which it wasn't as relevant as it is. But go ahead.
It's one of my favorite scenes on the park bench with Kevin Costner. And he starts out the scene by saying, "You wanted to have power over powerful men." And most people grab onto that line and they keep it, right? But at the end of the scene, she says, "I wanted to have power over powerful men." And he says, "No, I just said that to make you mad." Because in reality, she wanted to have power over her own life. She wanted to have power over her body. She wanted to have power over industry. And I think we're living in a society where women are now speaking to that. It's not about having power over men. It's about having power over our own agency. And so for me, the film is very timely. I'm so proud to be a part of this. I'm so proud to be alive right now in this time where so many women are coming forward and so many men are allies in creating gender equality.
You know, the process is whatever it needs to be for that. For whatever I'm doing, I envy people who, you know, they talk about how they go to the office at 9 a.m. and they write 20 pages and they go home at 6 o'clock and they're with their families. My life is nothing like that. Most of the time writing is spent not writing. It's spent climbing the walls, trying to figure out what to do. Molly's game came a little bit easier than others have. I'm not sure why, but even at that, it was months and months before I began the actual, you know, what looked like writing. I've never written an outline. I'll write index cards, but only 3 or 4, maybe 5 in a row. It's like walking ahead in the dark with a flashlight. You can really only see as far as you go, but the further you walk, the further you can see. And then once you have the ending, it's something to write toward. You asked about dialogue. That's the part that, you know, there's a lot of thinking that goes in. There's a lot of planning that goes in. I cling to intention and obstacle, those Aristotelian elements. Somebody's got to want something. Something's got to be standing in their way of getting it in every scene. But once you're loaded up, once you know what the scene is going to be, Jessica mentioned the scene on the bench with Kevin. Once you know what that scene is going to be from beginning to end, I like to try and write it as in the same amount of time it takes to type it, okay? And you can. When you know what you're doing, it comes that fast. That's when you know that it's good and right. If it's coming out like ketchup out of a bottle, stop. You're doing something wrong. But dialogue is the part of writing that that just... It takes a while to find your voice, and it's like playing the violin. It takes practice.
As a director, it's made you a better writer. Are you more philosophical about rewrites and killing your own chicks?
Well, we call it killing our darlings. I mean, killing baby chickens, it seems unnecessarily harsh. I'd rather cut one of my own lines. Well, first of all, I won't be able to answer the question as it made me a better writer until the next thing that I write. But, you know, I have to say there were a number of times, generally in prep, when I would be asked by the producers or the studio, and I do want to take my hat off to STX, it's a wonderful home to make a movie. They're kind of the new kids on the block, and they've been great. A few times I would be asked to just take off your writer cap and put on your director cap now. I only have one hat. I don't know how to take off the writer cap. I would see the necessity of cutting a scene that I liked in post-production. The editors would do a good job of showing me that a scene would work better without this line, or at this particular moment, I got a little eggy.
Thanks for filling on the chicks metaphor. That was
actually, I didn't even intend to do that. A little sappy, a little too much. I was doing work the actors can do for me. But I'll tell you that I'm glad that when I was writing the screenplay, I didn't know that I was going to be directing it, because I likely would not have, I probably would have been very conscious of that while I was writing it. I wouldn't have just let myself write at that moment I was talking about when, okay, you know what you're going to do, now go. And I certainly wouldn't have, there's more action in the first 8 minutes of this movie, in the first sequence of this movie, than there is in every other movie I've written combined. I don't think I would have, you know, I generally write something like that thinking, well, I'll let the director worry about, you know, how this crash is gonna work bit by bit. But I was glad that I didn't know it at the time. Well, it was great. I made sure that the first day was a relatively easy day. There was no such thing as an easy day on this movie, but it would be the second through, I don't know, 11th days or something that we did all the Molly Charlie scenes. I'll tell you, I was surrounded by a fantastic group of people. I went into this saying, don't pretend that you know more than you do. You'll be figured out. These people are smart. But you do know what you want. You know, you're not at sea with this. You know what you're looking for. So project that confidence. Lead. And people will follow. And in Jessica and Idris, I had, you know, real partners on the stage. So there were a lot of butterflies that first day, really every day. Once we got into it and were doing it, you would just get lost in the work.
It's sort of a pinnacle for most actors to, you know, get a chance to work on Aaron Sorkin, you know, written material. So I got a digital copy of the script and just stared at the email for a little bit. Just had a good old look at that. Then opened it and really had a good look at the first page. It was like, you know. But once I got over that moment, the script was an incredible page turner, as you'd expect. And, you know, I couldn't help thinking, how come I don't know this story? How do I not know this person? Like, I was really, really moved by Molly Bloom. I hadn't met her during the process before. And so I learned a lot. It was really well written. I thought, wow, you know, Aaron is really jumping into the deep end with a film like this to direct. I definitely admired his brave, his braveness for doing that.
Before I even open the script, I kind of knew I was going to say yes to it. I'd always wanted to work with Aaron. And when I started reading it, I was so blown away that for his directorial debut that he would put his attention on this, the female protagonist. A lot of people in the industry who've been in the industry for many, many years, you know, haven't done that. And so I was really, really pleased that he was focusing on this. And then also, can I just say how cool it is that he cast Idris Elba to play him in the movie? I mean, it really
what?
Is perfect casting.
What just happened?
I was worried he wasn't going to be quite cool enough to capture.
Carpet News, congratulations on a magnificent piece of cinema. My question to all of the panel, but perhaps starting with Jessica, I think this film could be summed up in one word, its integrity. And I'm curious what that word means to each of you, and if you've had a moment in your own life that, much like Molly's, it's been tested either professionally or personally.
And you want to start with me?
Yep. I know you have something.
You know, it's funny. And it's something from this movie, and I just can't remember what it was, but I do remember there was a moment on this movie on the phone with the producers where we were talking about something, and I just remember saying, it just doesn't sound like the right thing to do. Not meaning the strategy was right, from a sense of integrity. For the life of me, I can't remember what it is. But you know, I was lucky. I'll mention this because it my dad passed away a year ago this month, and so for me, my father was a man of who valued integrity, character, doing the right thing when nobody was looking, doing the right thing when not doing the right thing was a lot easier or more profitable. He at a very early age had me read Don Quixote, and it was a book that had a profound effect on me, it's why I enjoy writing romantically and idealistically. But you're right. If the movie could be summed up in a word, it would be integrity, or it would be decency. Nowadays, in particular, when you see that in someone, you know, it's like a cool glass of water in a desert.
Great question. But if I'm honest, I'll be really honest with you, I find it's hard to sort of answer questions like that at press conferences.
Yeah,
because they're very personal. And I like to do that on one-on-ones. But to say that, I think your observation, like Aaron's, is great about the fact of integrity. And I think there were moments in my life where, you know, that's happened over and over again where I've sort of gone, should I do the right thing or do the wrong thing? Should I stay on what? Similar to Aaron, my father is very, you know, has those same sort of principles. And every time I can, and oftentimes I've done the right thing and come out worse, right? Mm. But felt better about it. And that's ultimately something that I think you could see resonate in this film. In a time period, we talk about being timely, but in a time period where integrity for our population on this earth is something that we're all sort of like you say, it's missing somewhat, and you're going, where is it? So you see a piece of fiction, it's a film, it's based on someone real, but you take that away, that's a good thing. That's like, I'm very proud of being a part of that for that right now. Mm.
And I think Molly's thing at the end of this movie is that deep down she feels like, look, I'll make a comeback. I will get a job. I will I'll support myself somehow. But if you, Charlie, take this away from me, the only pure thing left in my life, my integrity, my name, never going to get that back, no matter what. And so she makes that decision. It comes easily to her.
Jessica, it's interesting that there are at least two men in this film who try to cap Molly's pay, and you've spoken very eloquently about the issues you've had with pay and taken a really powerful stand, I think. I just wanted to get your consent of how big a problem you still think this is and how difficult speaking out was about it and what kind of pushback you've had career-wise.
I think there's a lot of attention right now on actresses in Hollywood, just because the media really is focused on that. But I think it's also really important to recognize that it's what's happening in Hollywood is not only Hollywood. It's an it's a problem that is happening in society in terms of wage equality and harassment. You know, there was an article written to the actresses of Hollywood by over 700,000 female farm workers and talking about what they suffer to try to get food onto the table for their children. So whenever I discuss wage equality, I'm not talking about trying to get more money for people in Hollywood, because let's be honest, we are all overcompensated. So, you know, for we are paid very well. It's if there's two people working a job and one man is making $10 an hour and the woman is making $3 an hour, it's not right. So it doesn't matter what industry you're in, there needs to be some sense of equality. I just don't understand. It's 2017. Like, why are we even having this conversation still? So for me, I have definitely taken a stand and I've been very proactive. I ask my agents what other people are getting paid. Like, if someone's bringing me onto a film, I'll ask the actor who's asking me to be in the film, like, well, what's your salary? I'm just very, for me, I think there should be more transparency. If they want me to do the film with them, they will. I think for me, there's a big difference because I see every female character as being really, or not character, sorry. I see every woman as being a strong woman. I think that in the media and in films especially, they're just not well-written female characters. So they haven't portrayed them to be strong. Which I've had a problem with. So I always really search for well-written female characters, which means that they're not there defined by the man in their life. They're defined by what they do and what they say, which, shockingly, it's rare to find those characters. Not anymore so much with me. I'm really lucky that people, my friends and, actors and writers know that if they send me a script and it's not a great female character, I'm going to tell them. So for the most part, I am sent really well-written female characters. But also, what's interesting to me is a strength in a female character, she can be ambitious and aggressive and intelligent, but she can also, I've played female characters who are gentle and kind and compassionate and shy, but also still have a great strength to them. So there's no characteristics that define what strength is in women. Just all women are strong.
Great.